Welcome to a live session of Ask an Imam. My name is Farhan Iqbal, and this is a live program where you can ask any questions about Islam, Ahmadiyyat, other world religions. Answers are provided in light of resources that are found on the official website of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, that is www.alislam.org, alislam.org, the official website of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. This program is being broadcast on multiple platforms, that includes Twitter, Facebook, YouTube, and Twitch. On any of these platforms, you can submit your questions through the option of chat. On Twitter, there is right into the mainstream. You can use the feature to submit your question or comment. On Facebook, you can use the comment section to submit your questions. And on YouTube, you can use the live chat that is right next to the video to submit your question or comment on Islam, on Ahmadiyyat, on other world religions. As I mentioned, this is an Ask an Imam where you can ask any questions about Islam, about Ahmadiyyat, about other world religions. This broadcast is linked with the official website of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, www.alislam.org. That is alislam.org. When we go to the official website of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, one thing that I keep reminding you of is that on the very main page, there are press releases. So we have on the main page, the head of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community holds historic class with Jamia Ahmadiyya Bangladesh. This is the press release from February 16th. It contains details of the discussion that was held in this historic meeting of the of Hazrat Khalifatul Masih with the students of Jamia Ahmadiyya Bangladesh. Similarly, there are many different articles, different links on the main page, and you know, the topics tend to be related to contemporary issues as well. So for instance, in the Islam section, you have selected topics on the character of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and you have some information on that. Similarly, you have jihad and terrorism. Women in Islam is a topic that is often discussed or talked about. So these are the resources that are available that are being updated. As time passes, the new articles, new videos are being added to these different sections on alislam.org. I already have some questions that have started coming in. So one person has asked, okay, a lot of people have said salam, wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. One person has asked that my question is, can we recite the Holy Quran from a phone app in Jamaati programs? There was a circular some time ago from Huzur-e Anwar, may Allah be his helper, where he said that as far as you know, a formal program is concerned, we should not use a phone or an app to recite the Quran. In fact, we should actually read from the physical copy of the Holy Quran. So that is something that that we should do, that in a formal program we should recite from the actual hard copy of the Holy Quran instead of using an app of some nature, just because it's more respectful and more formal in those settings that we should do that. Okay, and that is circular. If you're looking for it, you can ask the president of your community wherever you are, and they can share this information with you. Another person has asked from Twitter that if they can ask some questions. Sure, this is a program which is meant to take questions from viewers. So you are welcome to ask any questions about Islam, about Ahmadiyyat, about other world religions, and I would be it would be my pleasure to respond to your questions. As far as questions of an intimate nature is concerned, those questions are not taken. A question of a more private nature, they're not taken in this kind of program. But general questions on faith matters in Islam, Ahmadiyyat, and other world religions, definitely those questions can be taken up. All right. Another question has been asked by Shahzeb. from YouTube, more about Salah. When should I offer two rak'at during each of the Salat? You can get this information from the Muslim prayer book that is available on alislam.org, that is entitled Salat. So if you see on your screen the third option, Salat, the Muslim prayer book, takes you to the link with that book, and that book can be read online as a PDF and on these all these multiple formats. You can read this book. So when it comes to you know, offering the rak'at, they are all listed here. What is the obligation to offer prayers, importance of prayers, timings for prayers, conditions for prayers, all this is discussed here, and all the questions related to Salat are given in this book. Okay. Another person has asked that, are there any scholars from the Salaf who believed that Isa alayhi salam has died? Yes, there have been scholars like Imam Malik, for instance, who believed that that Hazrat Isa alayhi salam, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, has died. And then there is Ibn Hazm as well, who believed that Isa alayhi salam has died. Similarly, there have been other scholars. And what is noteworthy, and this is something that I was just reading today in one of the books of the promised Messiah alayhi salam, he has noted that as far as those scholars are concerned, no one has objected to this opinion of theirs. We don't have evidence of people writing against this opinion that Jesus Christ has died. So they had this opinion that Jesus Christ has died, and no one wrote against that, no one opposed that, which is very interesting, that this is something that was, it appears to have been widely accepted, that Isa alayhi salam has passed away. All right, another question. What does Islam say about racism? This is a question from Twitter. What does Islam say about racism? So in the eyes of Allah, you know, in the very religion of Islam, the way our Hajj, for instance, the pilgrimage in Islam takes place, and the way that we have our mosques as such that there is no distinction between rich or poor, white or black. There's no segregation between any of the races or cultures, and everyone stands in the same room, whether they are rich or they are poor. There's no status difference. There's no no one is given any kind of preference over anyone. So when we look at that, that itself is a teaching against racism, against any kind of discrimination against anyone. But there are statements of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also to this effect. For instance, at the time of the last sermon, the farewell sermon that he gave, he said that no white person has superiority over a black person, and no black person has superiority over a white person. No Arab has superiority over a non-Arab. No non-Arab has a superiority over an Arab. So these are very clear statements about equality. The Quran also talks about equality. The Quran talks about that the only person who is most worthy of honor in the sight of Allah is the one who is the most righteous. Now, if you want to study this in more detail, I suggest that you go to alislam.org and type in Islam and human rights. If you type in Islam and human rights, you come across this link, this book by Sir Zafrullah Khan Sahib radiallahu anhu, who wrote this book on human rights, and he, you know, all the related references are given here from the Quran, from the Ahadith. So he took the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, and he took the articles, and he showed how those articles are all found in the teachings of Islam. So all these articles are quoted here of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, and then he goes on to prove that they are all contained in the Quran and in the Ahadith as well. So you can have a read if you are looking for a more comprehensive study of the subject of racism and human rights in Islam. Okay. Another question that has been asked from YouTube is, what is the revelation of the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, moon of the prophets? What does it signify? This is the revelation of the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, regarding Hazrat Mirza Bashir Ahmad, radiallahu anhu. I personally have not looked into the interpretation and how this prophecy was fulfilled, but generally speaking, it was a reference to his knowledge, and he's someone who has written many books in the defense of Islam. He has written the biography, the seerah of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and many other books where he has defended the teachings of Islam. He has defended in that book, in the seerah book, Khatamun Nabiyyin, which has been translated as Life and Character of the Seal of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In that book, he has defended the honor of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So I can think of these achievements of Hazrat Mirza Bashir Ahmad radiallahu anhu as a fulfillment of this revelation regarding him. But more specifically, I have not looked into this. If you want, you can go to alislam.org, type in Tazkara, and see if this has been explained in that section of Tazkara. So if we let me see if I can quickly find this here. If I don't find it here, then I accidentally refreshed this page. I was supposed to say Control F or Command F. Moon of the Prophets. If I'm able to find it, then maybe we can right away check the reference. It is still loading, and if it does show up, I will come back to this question and see if I have something further to say on that. Another question from YouTube is that a non-Ahmadi was saying to me that the promised Messiah alayhi salam cannot be Isa alayhi salam because Muslim scholars historically never tried to interpret Islamic eschatology using a biblical lens. Okay, so first of all, we are not using a biblical lens to interpret Islamic eschatology. There have been great ulama in the history of Islam who have believed that Isa alayhi salam has died. There has been even a sect within Islam whose official, one of their official doctrines was that Isa alayhi salam has died, and that is the Mu'tazilites or Mu'tazila. They believe that Jesus Christ has passed away. Imam Malik, I was just talking about him a little bit earlier, believed that Isa alayhi salam has died. Similarly, there have been others who believed that Isa alayhi salam has died. So this interpretation that Isa alayhi salam has died is not something that is different or that is new when it comes to the promised Messiah alayhi salam. This is something that has been held as a belief by the other Muslims. So this question about the moon of the prophets that I was trying to address, I have found, I'll get back to the question that I was just answering in just a moment. I have found the references on Tazkara, it's in Tazkara page number 279, and I already showed you earlier how to get to Tazkara. So it's on page 279, and there is some discussion that the birth of a second son whose name is Bashir Ahmad was foretold in a prophecy which is printed on page 266 of Aina Kamalate Islam. The words of this prophecy are as follows: the moon of the prophets will arrive, and your affair will become manifest. By Fazl, being near was meant that his coming would be a source of grace, right? Source of grace. And also that in his features and build, he will be like Fazl Ahmad, my son from my other wife. This son was born according to prophecy. So there is some discussion here. I'm not sure if it fulfills your desire, but go to Tazkara and type, do the search of the term moon. I see that there are 22 matches. So go through all those matches and see if there's some kind of note that is given similar to this one that explains this, and see the prophecy in its context as well, because in this case, it's not just Qamarul Anbiya as a single prophecy or revelation, it's a full statement. The moon of the prophets will arrive and your affair will become manifest. Allah will make your countenance cheerful and will illumine your reasoning. Soon a son will be born to you and grace will come close to you. My light is near. So there's some discussion here. Try and see if you can find more details. Now back to the other question about interpreting Islamic prophecies in light of the in using a biblical lens. That is not a true understanding. We don't use the Bible to interpret Islamic teachings. Islamic teachings are complete and perfect on their own, and so we are using Islamic history and the fact that even the scholars in Islam have stated very clearly that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, passed away, and there has been the concept of metaphors or the concept of prophecies being fulfilled in a certain way. And I'll give you one example. The prophecy about the Dajjal, right? The prophecy about the Dajjal states a lot of things like he would be one-eyed and he would have the letters Kaf, Fa, and Ra written on his forehead, and he would be able to travel from east to west, and a lot of things that are superhuman, right? But at the time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there was a person named Ibn Sayyad who was presumed to be the Dajjal, right? It was presumed that he is the Dajjal. In fact, this was mentioned in front of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam by Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu, and the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not disagree with him. So there was the door was open to the interpretation that this person is the Dajjal. Even though that the prophecies were saying a lot of other things. So it means that the interpretation that was being made was metaphorical, that maybe those things that have been stated in prophecy are fulfilled in this person in some metaphorical way. Of course, eventually we know that Ibn Sayyad, according to historical narrations, eventually became a Muslim, and there was nothing that came out of that. So it means that someone else was supposed to be the Dajjal. So to suggest that we are just using the Bible to make some interpretations, that is incorrect. We have examples in the history of Islam where these kinds of interpretations have been made, where it is very, very clear that Jesus Christ was believed to have passed away, to have died. So to suggest this would be wrong. But at the same time, there is nothing wrong there's nothing wrong with looking at the Bible, because some of the history of the prophets is mentioned in the book in Bible, and even if we do not consider the Bible to be the Word of God in its fullest form from start to finish, it contains information, historical information that can be useful to understand how things happened in the past and how some of the prophecies were fulfilled in the past. So for instance, the prophecy about the second coming of Elijah, right? The Jews were waiting for the second coming of Elijah from the heavens. They were waiting for him to physically descend from the heavens before the Messiah comes, right? And of course, when Jesus Christ came, he said, no, Elijah is actually has passed away. It is John the Baptist, Hazrat Yahya alayhi salam, who fulfills the prophecy of the second coming of Elijah, and that's why he is the Messiah who has come after John the Baptist. So this interpretation we understand is a prophetic interpretation, and so we should accept it, right? It's part of history, but I've already given you the example of how the same can be understood from Islamic sources as well. Okay. Tayyib Mahmood Sahib has asked from YouTube that if I start Zuhr Namaz and by the time I finish the four farz, it is well into Asr time, am I supposed to recite the two sunnah or is it too late? If it's too late, do I combine with Asr? So if you are starting the Zuhr time, the Zuhr prayer, at a time where you are almost into Asr time, then perhaps it would be better to just combine the prayer. But of course, that is not recommended. We should offer our prayers on time and at the earliest time available. It is a hadith of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also that the best time to offer the prayer is at the earliest time when the prayer time begins. Of course, in some certain circumstances, and I hope your question was about those circumstances when you are not able to offer prayer, despite your desire to offer prayer early, that you are offering it a little late. But do keep in mind that when it comes to Zuhr and Asr time, there's no demarcation, black and white line that after this time you cannot offer Zuhr and the Asr time has begun. Because there's a more gradual change from Zuhr into Asr. So there is even a time between Zuhr and Asr where Zuhr can also be offered and Asr can also be offered. And so it doesn't shift from one time to the next, on the dot or on the same, on 1 minute it is Zuhr time, and the next minute is Asr time. That's not how it is. It is more gradual, the change. So it's basically Zuhr time begins after the sun has begun its decline, right? And Asr time is when the sun has gone way down on the horizon and it is late afternoon. Okay, so there is we do, for the sake of convenience, we put some time on our calendars to make it easy for people to come to the mosque to offer the prayers. But the shifting of that time is more gradual. Just keep that in mind. So if you are still at Zuhr time, it's better that you just offer Zuhr. But if it's getting close to Asr time, then you can combine the prayer. Okay, another question from Twitter is that what is the major fact of difference Ahmadis from other Muslims? When it comes to Ahmadis and other Muslims, the major point of difference is basically the coming of the promised Messiah. And if you go to alislam.org, you can learn more about the promised Messiah. On the top green bar, it says promised Messiah. You click on promised Messiah and you come to a page that is dedicated towards information regarding the promised Messiah, Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, peace be upon him. So what does it say about him in the Quran, in the Ahadith, documentaries, signs, claims, message, legacy, his books that have been translated into English. There are several of them now, articles about him. So all this information is available on this page. The bottom line is that non-Ahmadi Muslims are still waiting for the coming of the promised Messiah, while Ahmadis believe that the promised Messiah has come, and his name is Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, peace be upon him. He was born in 1835 and he died in 1908. Another question from YouTube. I have a question. A few days ago, I was reading Tazkara and I found something disturbing. He said that he was God in a dream, and God forbid, what did he mean? Or am I confused because that sounds like shirk? Okay, so I'm surprised that when you read this in Tazkara, you did not find a note that explains or the context in which this was written. So if you can, I'm not sure if you were reading the actual Tazkara book in PDF format, or you were reading a quotation or a page out of it. So I do recommend that when you're reading something like this, do look at the footnotes. Sometimes there is a detailed explanation in the footnotes as well. In this case, the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, is talking about a dream. So we see things in dreams and they are almost never literal. These are just metaphorical. So the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, seeing himself as God in a dream, is not something that is new about dream interpretation. In fact, when you look at the science of dream interpretation, it talks about such dreams where a person sees themselves as God and there's an interpretation related to that. So I don't recall exactly which dream you're referring to. There are dreams that I'm thinking of where he saw God and God was signing a piece of paper or something like that. And there's a sign of red drops, by the way, that is also there. But this dream, again, what I can do is, I have a lot of questions, but a quick look at alislam.org, quick look at Tazkira, and what we can do is do a quick search and see if I can find this with you. And we can get some idea as to what the context was. If you remember the page number and everything, it would be nice. We can go to that page number and see what the whole context was and what the dream was. So he's still searching. Tazkira is a big book, by the way. So it takes time to search for certain terms. So I will get back to this question if I'm able to find something in the actual PDF of Tazkira. Okay, so one of the viewers of the program already explained that if you keep on reading in Tazkira, you will get the interpretation as well. Shahzeb has asked from YouTube, how, and this question was asked, I did not realize that it is, I have been talking for a while, so I have a lot of questions here. I did not realize that. So I'll try to speed up my answers a little bit. How do you define Wahi or Ilham? And let us, and us pious Muslims, other Muslims claim that they heard Allah's voice is at prophethood because direct speech would be Nubuwwat. Direct speech is not to be interpreted as Nubuwwat. Nubuwwat or being a prophet is a status that Allah gives to certain people. But as far as Wahi or Ilham is concerned, it is up to Allah. If He chooses, He can speak to some of His chosen servants. How do we define Wahi or Ilham? This is mentioned in the Quran as well. So, there is this verse of the Holy Quran that let me quickly try to find it for you. The verse is "Ma kana li basharin an yukallimahu Allahu illa wahyan." Right? Yukallimahu. Right? I am showing you how you can use this search engine to search for certain terms. There it is. وَمَا كَانَ لِبَشَرٍ أَن يُكَلِّمَهُ اللَّهُ إِلَّا وَحْيًا أَوْ مِنْ وَرَاءِ حِجَابٍ أَوْ يُرْسِلَ رَسُولًا فَيُوحِيَ بِإِذْنِهِ مَا يَشَاءُ إِنَّهُ عَلِيٌّ حَكِيمٌ. This is from chapter 42, verse 52. And it is not for a man that Allah should speak to him except by revelation or from behind a veil or by sending a messenger to reveal by his command what he pleases. Surely he is wise, he is high and wise. So this is not a reference that whoever Allah speaks to is going to be, that person is going to become a prophet. Another person has asked from YouTube, can you recommend a book or something on euthanasia, an Islamic perspective on it? I couldn't find much about it on Al-Islam. If you typed on, I'm surprised you did not get this, there is a question and answer session of Hazrat Mirza Tahir Ahmed, Rahimahullah Ta'ala, where he explains it at length. I'm surprised that you were not able to find much. There is this one. So it is a very short. So this Ask Islam, there is a 5-minute answer by, and it's on video answer as well. Is there any ever any justification for euthanasia? This is by Azhar Mirza Tahir Ahmed, Rahimahullah Ta'ala. You can look at it here. And listen to his answer. It's very thorough. I hope that suffices your need. While we are at Ask Islam, I just recall that in my previous live stream, I was asked this question about a Jalali Masih coming, and I actually typed in Jalali with one A, but if you type it in with two A's, you will come across this question. can a Jalali Messiah, the Jalali Messiah prophesied by Muhammad, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, be a greater prophet than the promised Messiah alayhi salam? So this is an interesting topic, and it's responded here by Hazrat Mirza Tahir Ahmad rahimahullah ta'ala. This is what I was looking for in my previous live stream. I couldn't find it. So I have shared it with you here. Okay. Another question from, follow-up question from Twitter is that, back to the topic with racism, why has God created hate for others for being different? You know, this, first of all, we have to understand that God has not created hatred. God is a God of love. He created love. It is the absence of love which is hatred. Similar to how God has created light. You know, or light is what is created. A shadow is not what is created. A shadow is merely the absence of light in a certain place. So make sure you understand this distinction between what is created and what is the absence of that creation. Life is created. Health is created. It's the absence of life or the absence of health that is pain or suffering or, poor health. Right? Poor health is not something that is created. So God has not created hate. He has created love. Another question is, what is the need of a prophet if everyone can receive communication from Allah? Well, if everyone can receive communication from Allah, it doesn't mean that they are ready to become messengers of Allah. It doesn't mean that they can become Uswai Hasana. Right? Remember, the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has been called Uswatun Hasanatun, the best role model, and practically every prophet is a good role model for others to follow. Not everyone who receives revelation is the perfect role model. Not everyone who receives revelation would have the capacity to deliver the message to others. So prophets of Allah have been given this capacity, the courage, the ability to take the message from Allah and deliver it to the people with courage. Not everyone who receives revelations from Allah can have that or has that courage or ability or, to deal with all the pressure of being a prophet of Allah. Those who are prophets of Allah are specifically chosen by Allah to endure hardship and suffering and be able to deliver the message regardless. So these are some of the reasons. In other cases, Allah is communicating with his loved ones on occasion, right? In some cases, there are just a handful of revelations that Allah may grant to some individuals, and those are only for that individual in those circumstances. But a prophet of Allah is receiving revelations almost on a daily basis to maintain that continuous contact so that they are able to deliver all of their message in its full requirement. The other thing is that when it comes to a prophet is needed for the guidance of others at certain times in history. When humankind has moved away from the right path, Allah sends a prophet to bring them back to the right path, right? So they come on special occasions when they are needed the most. Another person has asked that, is Hazrat Adam alayhi salam the first person in the world? So we do not believe Hazrat Adam alayhi salam to be the first person in the world. We, however, do believe in him as the first prophet of Allah in this world. There were other human beings who came before him as well. All right. So unfortunately, sometimes some people come to this program and they start trolling or giving messages that are very insulting or derogatory or making fun, those kind of messages will not be tolerated in this kind of program. That's why I'm not able to show you these messages most of the time, because there are some messages that need to be filtered. That's why we show some care when it comes to sharing messages here. And this is a healthy dialogue. You can disagree with me, but it doesn't mean that we have to start insulting the other person in the anonymity that is provided by the internet. Another question that has been asked is that, is practicing hypnotism against Islam? The Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said, innamal amalu bin niyyat. All actions are to be judged based on intentions. So if the intention is, for instance, hypnosis is to be done on a person who has been through some trauma and it can heal them, bring them out of that trauma, then it is allowed because it is beneficial. But if hypnosis is done to harm someone in some way, then it is not allowed. So it depends on a case-by-case scenario. Another question is, what is black magic in Islam? There is no such thing as this kind of magic where you can do magical things to harm others. There are some resources on alislam.org that deal with this topic. So if you go to alislam.org, type in black magic, and you will get, again, we come back, we started with Ask Islam and we come back to this. Islam and witchcraft is, there is a question and answer here. So you can read some of this to get more information on this topic. And the person who asked me about the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, using the Bible as a lens to talk about his own coming, that's by way of example, right? Where we talk about the example in history where Elijah came, Elijah was expected to come, physically descend from heaven, and Jesus Christ told his followers that this is not going to happen physically or literally. This prophecy has been fulfilled metaphorically in the person of John the Baptist. But that is by way of example. There are examples, as I talked about earlier, from Islamic history and sources as well. Okay. Some questions here that I'm trying to read through. How does Islam view the will and focus? I'm not sure what you are referring to. If you can elaborate this question a little more, then I can maybe comment on that. Another question is there a rule to recite different surahs every rakat of the day if you know enough chapters of the Holy Quran? How about reciting one chapter twice a day in my prayers? Is it not recommended? You can recite any surah you like. And don't worry about repetition. If you like a surah and you want to recite it over and over, you can recite it over and over. There's no harm in that. If you know more chapters, surahs of the Holy Quran, then you can recite more of those chapters in your prayers. There's nothing wrong with that. The true objective of prayer is to feel that connection with God Almighty. So strive to achieve that connection with God Almighty. Personally, and everyone can have that personal, but there are prayers in the Holy Quran. Like, for instance, there is the last three verses of Surah Al-Baqarah that I like to recite from time to time, where there's a lot of prayer for forgiveness, right? So maybe you can, if you know those portions, you can recite them more often because they contain a lot of prayers that a believer or a Muslim can offer. Which book would you recommend that can help us be better in tabligh and debates? Depends on whom you're talking to. There are two major groups that we come across in the West. One is atheists, who do not believe in God at all. In order to preach to them, you should know some of the arguments related to atheists. So if you go to alislam.org, there's actually, if you just scroll down from the main page under Islam, it says Allah and then click more. So if you click more, you will come to a page that is dedicated to the concept of God and related material. If you scroll all the way to the bottom, there's a book, Our God, that tackles atheism. Similarly, there's a book, 10 Proofs for the Existence of God, Signs of the Living God. These are books that address the issue of atheism or prove the existence of God Almighty. If you're looking for even more for an even more thorough discussion of atheism, there is Brahini Ahmadiyya by the Promised Messiah alayhi salam that you can also find on alislam.org. Similarly, there is Christianity. If you're it's a big group that we face in the West, regarding Christianity, you can find books that are related to that topic. Jesus. When we are talking to Christians, Jesus comes up a lot. And there's actually a page on Jesus on Al-Islam. So you have all this material about Jesus that is here. Then we have generally speaking, when it comes to preaching, the books that we normally give, one of the books that we normally give is Philosophy of the Teachings of Islam. So you can share this book and read it first yourself. Another book that is for non-Ahmadi Muslims, Invitation to Ahmadiyyat. This book is also definitely very helpful when it comes to speaking to non-Ahmadi Muslims. It provides these arguments that we can address. So it depends whom you are addressing, whom you are talking to, what kind of conversation you are having with that person. So it depends on the situation, really. Okay, so the question that was asked of me earlier about Elijah and the return of Elijah, and the non-Ahmadis were saying, the questioner asks that the non-Ahmadis were saying the promised Messiah Islam cannot be Jesus like John was Elijah, because Islamic scholars never use this interpretation. Are you sure? I mean, what if we are able to find from Islamic sources scholars saying that yes, this is the correct interpretation? Right? What other interpretation could it be? Who was Yahya, and what was his Hazrat Yahya al-Islam, and what were his claims? This is all discussed in Islamic history as well. Now, the question to ask from such non-Ahmadi Muslims is that if we are able to show you from Islamic sources, from Islamic scholars, that this kind of interpretation was made even by Islamic scholars, would they then accept that promised Messiah alayhi salam is the promised one? So I think the issue is that we have to come back to the sources. We have to come back to our fundamental issues regarding the promised Messiah. We cannot say that just because scholars haven't made this interpretation, that's why I don't accept the promised Messiah. What is the proper way to judge the coming of a Messiah, the coming of a prophet? What does the Quran teach us regarding that? That is where the discussion has to begin, right? So it depends on how you move forward with the discussion. Another person has asked that I want to read the books of the promised Messiah al-Islam, but I don't know where to begin. Sometimes it is just a feeling, and it's fleeting. If you personally, I like to read the books in hard copy. Just pick up one of the books from your shelf and start reading. It does not have to be that difficult. I mean, right now, think of the next moment, next hour, 2 hours from now, or tomorrow morning. What would be your free time? In that free time, just pick up any book of the Promised Messiah Islam and start reading. Because a lot of times it's just that feeling, that initial nervousness or anxiety. But once you start reading, you will find that you are going to enjoy it, inshallah. Now, if you are really looking for a list, then one suggestion is to start with the books that he wrote later in life, which were simpler and addressed to a larger audience. For instance, you can pick up Noah's Ark by the Promised Messiah Islam and start reading that, if you haven't already. Similarly, you can read, like I just mentioned, the Philosophy of the Teachings of Islam. right? So these are books that you can start with. But to ask for, you know, there's no list. I mean, there are, the Khulafa have suggested some lists, and that can be obtained as well if you like. I've seen those lists in Urdu, and some of the books on that list, on those lists, have not been translated into English yet. So don't worry too much about the list itself. Just pick up Noah's Ark or Philosophy of the Teachings of Islam and start reading. And then once you start reading and get into the flow, inshallah, focus on the day-to-day reading, which is how many pages are you going to read today or tomorrow. Focus on that, and eventually you'll realize by the end of the month, after 60 days, after 90 days, you've already covered a lot, even if you're reading just 3, 5, 10 pages a day. All right. All right, I have a lot of questions here, and I am coming to the end of my stream here. So I'll just take a couple of more questions. In the history of the Jamaat, which scholar has been the greatest debater? Well, it's hard for, this is a very, this question, it's very hard to pinpoint any scholar. But in the history of the Jamaat, well, we can start with the Promised Messiah, peace be upon him. We know of some of the debates that he was personally involved in, and those are fantastic. They are not translated into English yet, but if you know how to read Urdu, that's where you should start. There was a debate with a Sunni scholar. There's a debate with Muhammad Hussain Batalvi. There is a debate with Abdullah Atam. So these debates are, that the proceedings of those debates are part of the Ruhani Khazain. And so you can read that, those as a start. Then, since then, there have been some debates, but most of them have been in the Urdu language. In the English language, the debate I can think of is called the Cairo debate. It's very interesting. The Cairo debate was, I forget the name of the scholar. I read this a few years ago. The Cairo debate is, yes, Maulana Abul Ata Jalindri. He's the one who represented the Ahmadiyya Muslim position, and on the other side was a Christian. So it's a wonderful, you can see it's from 1961. So the even the printing is very old, but it's a wonderful read if you can avoid, if you're okay with reading in that old format of printing. This is the typewriter print, and there's a photo of him here as well. So he's one of the great debaters in the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. He was also formerly principal of the Ahmadiyya Muslim Missionary College in Rabwa as well. So it's, you know, he's one of those, definitely. And you can read this book if you're interested. Okay, which book on Al-Sam? I have a person on Twitch who has asked me if he can ask a question. Sure, you can ask a question, but that would be the last question that I'm going to take for today. Which book on Al-Islam.org explains why evil exists and how it captures the beauty and magnificence of God? There is a book by Hazrat Mirza Tahir Ahmad, Rahimahullah Ta'ala. If you go to alislam.org and you type in revelation, rationality, knowledge and truth, there is a section in this book that talks about suffering. So the question of suffering, let me see where it is. There it is. Part two, last chapter in part two is the question of suffering. So that discusses this one aspect of this question. Similarly, you can go to alislam.org main page, and then on the right it says Ask Islam. Click on Ask Islam. On the Ask Islam page, you can search for why evil. So why does a God of love allow such evil to exist in the world today? You can listen to this answer, and it will also comprehensively address this issue for you. Okay, how do we prove the prophethood of Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, peace be upon him. Well, when it comes to the claims of the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, it's harder to jump to a claim of the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, and try to prove that claim. What we should start with is to first assess whether the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, is a true recipient of revelation. So in the Holy Quran, for instance, it says that those who are making false claims of being recipients of revelation, they will be killed by God. So for instance, we know that the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam lived 23 years after he made his claim. Now, a person who is making false claims of revelation from God cannot live longer than 23 years. It's not possible. It's not possible that Allah would allow an imposter to live longer, more than 23 years, and still be a false claimant of revelation. That's not possible, because then it dilutes the truthfulness of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we know the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam lived 23 years after he made his claims. Now let us look at the promised Messiah alaihi wasallam. His earliest claims to revelation come to us from the late 1860s. Okay, and if you really want to delay that, you can say mid 1870s is when publicly, at least in his family or extended family, they knew that he's making a claim that he is receiving revelation from God Almighty. After those initial claims, he continued to live for more than 35 years, right? That's a lot longer than 23 years. So that means that he is a true claimant of revelation from God. I have worked on an article that is going to talk about the truthfulness of the promised Messiah alayhi salam according to the Holy Quran. It is coming to alislam.org soon, so stay tuned for that, and I will talk about it in one of these live streams, and you can use that article as well, the various verses of the Holy Quran from that article that prove the truthfulness of the promised Messiah alayhi salam. Question from Twitch, and this will be the last one. A person has asked that I grew up in a Muslim household and practiced until my late teens, but over the years I've drifted from my religion somewhat and started asking more questions. It helps with my anxiety, helps me more compassionate towards other people. My question is, why is weed haram in Islam, and is there no way to consume weed in Islam a halal way? Well, weed is a form of drug, right? The Quran talks about khamr, things that intoxicate, that normally refers to alcohol, but anything that is intoxicating, the Quran talks about it. And the Quran says that there are some advantages and disadvantages, but the disadvantages are greater than the advantages, which is why alcohol and other things that intoxicate have been forbidden by God Almighty. Now, even with alcohol, if there is a situation where a person is suffering from some disease, where the only cure is that they take alcohol to recover from that illness, then it is allowed, because that is known in Islamic jurisprudence as a condition of istirar, or a condition where a person is in some situation where they cannot get out, and to save their life, this is something that is administered and prescribed for them. Even in the case of eating the forms of meat that are forbidden, including the meat of swines, right? The Quran is clear that even in those circumstances, regarding that meat that is haram, that can be consumed if it helps save the life of a person. Now, in your case, I don't know why you are consuming a form of drug, whether it is weed or any kind of drug, but if there is a situation where the only way to save a person's life or to cure a certain illness, the only prescription is a certain amount of consumption of a certain drug, that would be halal in that, in those circumstances. But to say that it makes me feel better or takes away my anxiety, then that is not good enough a reason for someone to be consuming intoxicating drugs. For that person, I suggest instead of taking drugs, they should seek some kind of counseling, some kind of mental health counseling or therapy that can bring them out, that can address the anxiety issues and bring them out of that anxiety in a more healthy way. Because remember, taking those drugs, including alcohol, all these kinds of, reason why the Quran has forbidden the consumption of these things is because they cause harm to us. So they cause us to, they are detrimental to our health. These things are alcohol causes a lot of deaths on a yearly basis in many countries of the world. Similarly, these drugs, they have a detrimental, especially for someone who might be very young. That is a sign that is something to be concerned about, because someone who is young, their mental health is impacted by the consumption of this drug, and their growth is also impacted. So you should consider all these factors, that in the long term, this kind of drug consumption can be harmful. All right, that's all the time I had for this live stream. There were a lot of questions asked, and I did not have the time to go into a lot of details with many of the questions. But I appreciate all of you who joined this program. It was a pleasure to have all of you join this program. Please do remember me and the alislam.org team in your prayers. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.